So workload, during physical exercise, you'll often think that you won't get, you know, if you're breathing through your nose during intense physical exercise, you're not going to reach 100% of your capacity because your nose imposes a resistance of 50%. So they've looked at it in studies. The benefits of nose breathing, this is an Australian study, by the way, is that it causes a reduction in the fraction of expired oxygen. If you breathe through your nose during recreational physical exercise, your cells will consume more oxygen. The amount of oxygen delivery to the cells is going to be higher. This is probably because when you breathe through your nose, you've got higher end tidal CO2. With higher end tidal CO2 in the lungs, in the blood, in the tissues, the amount of oxygen that's delivered to the cells increases. So the fraction of expired oxygen is less, meaning that the amount of oxygen extracted by the lungs is increased. While breathing through the nose only, all subjects could attain a work intensity great enough to produce an aerobic effect. So on average, athletes will tend to reach 90% of their workload. I think that's pretty good. Now, if you consider the amount of athletes that every time they go for a run, they would go for a run with their mouths open. Whereas in actual fact, they can attain a pretty good work rate by nose breathing. So you don't have to run with your mouth open to attain a good work rate. Nose breathing is good. This study here was presented at the Chartered Society of Physiotherapy's annual congress in 2009, and it looked at 12 healthy physiotherapy students, young people, 21 to 27 years of age. They were able to attain 85% of their VO2 peak, potentially high training load. So again, now these are probably looking at healthy individuals, people without asthma, without chronic obstruction, without chronic obstruction of the nose. But again, 85-90%, it's worth doing it. Now, I would say for you guys who are doing training, do at least some of your runs with your mouth closed, because it adds an extra load onto the body. When I was working with the sprinters in the United States, so they would do they were doing 200 and 400 meter sprinter, and the time of a sprint, the time that fatigue comes in, is going to be the last 25 meters. So the time to add the extra load here is the last 25 meters. So we had them nose breathe. I'd stand at about 375 meters. This is 400 meter. I had them nose breathe at an all-out sprint. And when they seen me at the last 25 meters, they had to breathe in, breathe out, and hold their breath. They held their breath to the last. So what I was doing was pushing them into a hypercapnic, hypoxic situation. I was pushing them into a major fatigue to get the body to make adaptations. Therefore, during the real thing, we weren't going to get the same fatigue at the end of the race. Does that make sense? Always, when does most fatigue set in? You see two football teams. The time of the problems are the last 10 to 15 minutes. That's when, during practice, they should be taped up. You add an extra load, the last 10 to 15 minutes of practice session, so then during the real event, there's an adaptation after taking place here.